comes to a killer ending, horror has a harder time sticking the landing than most movie genres. All an action flick needs is a decent explosion to eradicate the baddies. All a rom-com needs is the perfect kiss. Hell, all that a comedy has to do is leave the audience laughing. But it's a little more complicated in horror, where creators have chose between the cathartic relief of killing whatever evil has been plaguing the cast, or doubling down on the preceding terror by ending on a dark, hopeless note. It's such a difficult decision that even a lot of classic horrors have a hard time choosing a lane, and end up filming a happy ending only for the monster to pop up for one more, often inexplicable scare. Sorry, A Nightmare on Elm Street. However, sometimes directors are free to say, stuff the studio notes, and make as bleak and brutal an ending as they want. Some of the flicks on this list would never have worked without their iconic denouements, whereas some were scary enough already, and the vicious ending was just a touch too much. In any case, I'm Kirsten from What Culture, and these are the 10 most disturbing horror movie endings. Number 10, Sinister. We may praise this flick's impressive sequel from Eli director Kieran Foy later, but now it's time to address the original film's divisive ending. From the mind of recent Marvel exile Scott Derrickson, Sinister sees true crime author slash washed up alcoholic Ethan Hawke relocate his family to a haunted house in order to uncover the truth behind a string of gruesome deaths attached to the place. It's not long before he discovers a box of vintage snuff reels in the attic, and so begins a somber, moody, psychological thriller as he grows more obsessed with the murders, whilst also being haunted by shadowy children hiding throughout the dark house at night. That is, until the last half hour or so, wherein we discover that Marilyn Manson lookalike slash demon, Bagul, is the source of the many murders, and he's been using kids as conduits for his nefarious machinations. It's hard to make a circle of sprogs look unsettling in any circumstances, but laugh at your peril. Just when it seems like Hawke and family might escape unscathed, and even get a good book out of the experience, the entire family are drugged, tied up and summarily killed by his 7-year-old daughter under Bagul's control. Look, the image of a kid covering the walls of their house in their family's blood is undeniably disturbing. No one said the endings wouldn't also be illogical and unbelievably silly. Number 9, Oculus. Mike Flanagan has gone on to do incredible things for Netflix in the form of The Haunting of Hill House, as well as some more so-so things for the multiplex, such as last year's belated Shining sequel slash flop Dr. Sleep. But in 2013, he turned his attention to a haunted mirror, and armed with British starlet Karen Gillan as his leading lady, tried his hand at the multiple merging timelines trick, which has become something of a trademark in his later work. It's a fun story, switching from the childhoods of siblings Kaylee and Tim to their present-day existence as they return to the house of their youth and try to clear Tim of his parents' murder. You see, the haunted mirror tricked him into killing his parents, giving both himself and his father visions which drove them to madness and eventually murder. This time though, Kaylee has planned everything out and will be proving her brother's innocence whilst also destroying the mirror in the process. That is, unless the mirror gets up to its old tricks and manages to make Tim kill her by sending a spike set up to smash the mirror straight through her before it can hit the cursed surface. Number 8, The Midnight Meat Train. Okay, so British author Clive Barker isn't known for his cheerful endings at the best of times, but by swelling a little Lovecraftian horror into this torture porn flick, directed by Ryuhei Kitamura, really upped the ante for disturbing denouements. For much of this stylish but predictable flick's runtime, we follow New York photographer Leon as he pursues a mute murderer, played by Vinnie Jones of all people, who's offing users of the city's subway late at night. So far, so conventional. Then Leon does battle with the murderous butcher, and surprise surprise, actually successfully kills him. Score one for the good guys. We love to see it. That's when he discovers that said murderous butcher is in fact a literal butcher, killing individual humans to sate the hunger of an entire race of monstrous subterranean reptilians. So now that the position is empty and the monsters can't very well go unfed lest they pop open a manhole and feast on the city's inhabitants, it falls on Leon's shoulders to continue his bloody work. It's not a recommended path to employment, offing your predecessor, but it's a bloody effective one. Number 7, Hereditary. Ari Aster is already known for his uncomfortable endings, but the closer of his feature debut Hereditary really takes the biscuit. After making a shocking impression with his darkly comic short film The Strange Thing About the Johnsons, Aster helmed this occult horror slash family drama hybrid starring Toni Collette and Gabriel Byrne as a pair of grieving parents whose world begins to unravel after the sudden tragic death of their young daughter. As the film draws to a close, it switches its focus to the family's teenage son, piling hallucinations, delusions, and nightmares on his plate before adding a possessed mother and naked old cult members surrounding his house. If that weren't enough, the sight of your dear mum decapitating herself with piano wire would be enough to push anyone over the edge. And it's understandable that the teen takes a quick trip out an upstairs window to escape whatever evil is inhabiting his home. Unfortunately, the fall costs him his life, or possibly just his sanity if you're a fan of the more optimistic reading, leaving him ready to stroll into his treehouse and into the arms of the awaiting cult, who can now use his body to resurrect the demon Paimon. So, everything went to plan. For the demonic cult, that is. Shame about the innocent family. Number 6, The Mist. It's only fair to throw in this entry, since Frank Darabont's actually pretty solid adaptation of Stephen King's novella The Mist is mostly known for its incredible and incredibly cruel ending. The Shawshank Redemption helmer must have felt his foray into King's story was too cheery when he decided to take on this slow-burning story of a town besieged by interdimensional monsters in the titular mist. When the townspeople hole up in a supermarket, it's only a matter of time before the classic Stephen King archetypes arise, and Mrs. Carmody, the token religious zealot, soon whips herself up a mob and decides it's time to sacrifice some fellow townsfolk to the eponymous weather irregularity. Fortunately, our heroes escape. Well, most of them. There's no knowing what happened to the future Brooklyn Nine-Nine star Andre Brower's level-headed lawyer, and drive far, far away. However, upon realizing the mist extends far further than they imagined, exhausted dad Thomas Jane kills the two elderly tagalongs, his love interest, and his own son, before running out of bullets. So he runs out of the car and begs the monsters to end his suffering, which is when he sees the army clearing the mist and saving survivors, just about 2 minutes too late. Number 5, The Skeleton Key. There's not a lot to recommend about The Skeleton Key. A mid-noughties chiller starring Kate Hudson and set in the sweaty swamps of the Louisiana Bayou, outside of some corny scares involving all manner of voodoo rituals and a game pair of supporting turns from John Hurt and Gina Rowlands. It's probably no surprise that infamous Scream 3 / Ring 2 / Arlington Road scribe Aaron Kruger was behind the flick's script. Obviously, he didn't inherit Uncle Freddy's talent for the original scares. Yes, we know it's spelt different, but come on, it's very close. However, the film does have a banger of an ending, and it's a surprisingly brutal conclusion to an otherwise by-the-numbers chiller. After hospice nurse and general good person Caroline has tried to save ailing old man Ben from his wife Violet, it's revealed that her love interest Luke's body has already been taken over by Ben, trapping Luke's consciousness in Ben's paralyzed body. You see, Violet and her husband are actually voodoo practitioners, bent on stealing bodies in order to live another lifetime, which they succeeded in doing, leaving poor Caroline trapped in the body of her former charge. It's a memorably nasty twist on the I have no mouth and must scream nightmare, and sticks with the viewer longer than the rest of the forgettable flick. Number 4, Night of the Living Dead. This one may be the most infamous on this list, but it's also the most poignant and pointed. George A. Romero's first foray into the land of the recently revived Walking Dead ends on a nihilistic note, which underscores the film's social commentary as well as cementing its place in horror history. Ben, the sole survivor of the unbearably tense and increasingly hopeless night-long siege, finally manages to escape the cellar he's been forced to hole up in after dispatching his former fellow survivors once they turned into reanimated people-eaters. He walks out into the sunshine and, in a moment perfectly parodied decades later in Eli Roth's feature debut Cabin Fever, is promptly shot by a posse who are out hunting zombies, and evidently failing to do their due diligence. It's no coincidence that Ben is a rare black hero in horror, and there's a sharp insight into the horrors of racial stereotyping in the thoughtless way which the locals dispatch him without a word of warning or any attempt at communication. A clear message that they never viewed him as human. The ending presages Romero's series-long recurring focus on the failings of his human characters, culminating in Land of the Dead, wherein the zombies are some of the least evil beings on screen. Number 3, Eli. Released last year, Netflix original Eli is the latest from Irish horror helmer Kieran Foy, of better than the original Sinister 2 fame. Following the titular troubled child as his parents move him into a care facility due to his debilitating illness, the film starts out like a horror remix of The Boy in the Bubble, as we're left wondering whether this kid is actually allergic to the rest of the world, and if not, why his folks so dead set on hiding him from it. That is, until the flick's last act, wherein we learn the eponymous Sprog is actually the son of Satan. The product of his dear mum making a Faustian bargain in order to have the child she always wanted. This realization doesn't settle well for the little lad, who proceeds to kill every doctor and orderly in the facility, as well as his supposed dad. Not Satan, the human one. Oh, and the kid he befriends, played by Stranger Things star Sadie Sink, yeah, she's another of the Antichrist offspring. It's a pretty vicious turn, but longtime fans of Foy's work would have known what to expect from the flick, as the director's early short, The Fairies of Blackheath Woods, also features a brutally cruel ending, serving as an effective calling card for the Helmer's singular style. Number 2, Fallen. This one is an odd inclusion on this list, given the fact that star Denzel Washington claimed he turned down Brad Pitt's role in Seven due to how unrelentingly bleak the script was. We're not sure what made him think Fallen was any less cruel, but the gloomy late 90s supernatural thriller is an underrated horror slash psychological procedural mashup not unlike Frailty. However, much like that other paranormal detective flick, Fallen packs a hell of a punch, with its last minute twist leaving viewers reeling. It shouldn't have been a surprise for audiences, given the fact that director Gregory Hobbit's last flick before this one was Primal Fear. The film follows Washington's detective Hobbs as he narrates his pursuit of the body-hopping demon Azazel, responsible for a string of grisly murders. Eventually, he succeeds in stranding the demon in the middle of nowhere, forcing it to inhabit his body, and offing himself, killing the demon and avenging his murdered brother in the process. That is, until we find out Azazel can just body surf into a random cat, an ability we were never informed of, and we realise the entire narration has been from the demon's POV, not the now pointlessly deceased hero. Brutal. Number 1, Funny Games. Genre nerds and highbrow film fans probably knew it was only a matter of time before this entry made its way onto any list of disturbing endings in the horror genre, even though director Mikael Haneke probably wouldn't consider the flick a conventional horror. He is much too self-congratulatory for that. The simple but brutally effective home invasion thriller sees a pair of well-mannered young men progress from harmless pranks to torture and murder in a matter of minutes, putting a couple and their young son through countless trials as they pick them off one by one. It's all very smug, prompting legendary critic Mark Kermode to write off the flick's meta provocations by comparing them to Wayne's World. You see, the pair address the audience numerous times throughout the film's never-ending runtime, winking and pulling faces, as well as even rewinding the film's action at one point. Still, the smarmy self-referentiality doesn't blunt the undeniable effectiveness of the ending, wherein the pair succeed in murdering the entire family with no comeuppance, only to move on to another house and repeat the cycle on new victims. Very meaningful, very metaphorical, very utterly, hopelessly brutal. Anyone remember why this film was taken seriously but a Serbian film wasn't? And that's our list. If you haven't already, please like and subscribe and be sure to check out our other channels and videos. I've been Kirsten from What Culture,
and I'm actually a demon who has been possessing the body of Jules this whole time. Join our cult. Join us.